First and foremost, I would like to thank all of you who are here today, making an effort and taking the time to come here. And secondly, I would record my gratitude to PIPA for organizing this forum at such short notice. And in fact, it was just hatched last week. And I praise them for their efficiency in organization and execution. Thank you to you who come and to PIPA as well. I am a Sabahan. I came from Sabah, the poorest state in Malaysia. And my district is the Pitas Paitan area, which is the poorest in Sabah. So I am from the poorest of the poorest in Malaysia. I am an economist by training, so I will be giving you my opinions on issues of economics. And if you like my opinions or you support my opinions, you can adopt it as your own. And if you feel that it needs to be enhanced, you may probably do so. And towards the end of my presentation, I will touch on three legal issues. I'm also legally trained, and I hope I will be able to impart useful information and knowledge to you. My learned friend, Mr. Peter Marajin, will be taking questions in the Q&A session. Peter suka disoal siasat bah, so he prefer to be in the Q&A. So without further ado, I will go straight into what I want to impart to you people. Now, there are actually many types of economics. For instance, human resource economics, finance economics, we have industrial economics, which is basically factory economics. And I remember reading in the paper that our Prime Minister Najib was economist trained in Great Britain in the newspaper. And I Googled and found out that I will give you an example of to Donald Stevens and to others to start about endogenous economics. Endogenous means internal. Prime Minister. He answered a question in Parliament. He told the August House that there are about 9 million taxpayers in the country out of a population of 27 million. And 90% of the taxpayers are Chinese. It's not what I say, you know, it's what the Prime Minister said at that time. So it means to say, those who are not Chinese are actually not paying taxes or You have to make your own deduction. So is it fair? So I would say, you impose GST on everything, so that semua orang kena apa. But you do away with all the other taxes, so that we know what we are paying for, so that we will not be investigated by the Inland Revenue Department a few years after we have filed our return. Isn't that a better deal? Okay. Now, some taxes should be abolished, like road tax. We have to go to pay every 6 months or 12 months to get a disc so that we can display. Sometimes we forget. Sometimes the chichirwa. And most of the time we are being victimized in roadblocks. And most of the time there are incidences that only ends in the payment of money. Now let me tell you, for many decades, a lot of countries in the world do not collect road tax. They have abolished it. And there are also countries that in road tax, berapa sen satu liter kan, fuel that you buy at the service station, so that if you drive a 6,000cc car, kamu kena pay kan. So you pay. Kalau engine 600cc tidak kuat minum, bayar sikit road tax lah. Or if your car is kept in the house, tidak pakai minyak, tidak payah isi minyak, tidak payah bayar road tax. Kalau hari-hari pakai, hari-hari isi minyak, hari-hari pakai road tax, bayar road tax. Betul tak? Which is fair, isn't it? And how come after 40, 50 years, our government doesn't know how to do this? I have been to a Scandinavian nation. Setiap kereta dipasang dengan GPS. Dua sebab. That is a country where it's so huge, and the weather can be very unforgiving. Jalan. So the amount of road. And how come we don't have it here after 52 years? Now, this is not a political speech. And I've made it very clear to the organizers that during Q&A, I will not answer ridiculous, political, or irrelevant questions. Legal issues should be asked by Mr. Peter Marajin. Unless that this is so easy, I let Jeremiah answer it. Okay. Now, the next thing, how much actually will actually reach the to Sabah was never paid. The last I read, the limitation ordinance of Sabah, kalau itu hapus wah. And I read the limitation act, sama juga wah. There's a time frame for you to. Be something technical or something very real. But a responsible government in the world the first thing to do is cut interest rates. All the housing loan, the car loan, the education loan, the credit card loan, semua potong ba itu kadar faedah. Kita punya macam tiada kan? Tidak pernah kan? Kenapa? In 97 and 98, we have the Asian financial crisis. The Central Bank of Thailand cut interest sampai bankers here. BLR kosong. Zero. And then a few years back, United Kingdom, Bank of England, kosong juga. So, which means to say that you do not pay interest on your loans, you just pay back the principal. And baru-baru ini kita punya ringgit jatuh nilai dengan dahsyat. And even China pun sama, the RMB jatuh juga. And the first thing they did was to cut interest rates. Interest rate is still at the same level. What is happening? Is Malaysia going bankrupt? Now, you will have to answer that yourself. But I will tell you how to reach that conclusion. You know, our EPF money, I think we have more than 10 million contributors. 10 juta. And every month, kita punya gaji kena potong, itu majikan pun kena potong untuk mencarum kepada tabung KWSP. And the last I read, we have about 408 billion ringgit on the books lah, in the books. And how much of our EPF money has been pumped into GLCs, government-linked corporations that are losing money? Is the EPF going to go bust? Well, it's this one. Bermakna 100 juta. Billion. Dalam KWSP sudah angus lah. Every month they will still have money to pay the people who are retiring. Betul tak? So you see, there is a difference between liquidity and solvency. Liquidity means tunai cair dalam tangan. Solvency is the ability to pay long-term debts. So in my opinion, the government will not go bankrupt because every month, every day, they are still collecting taxes like GST from the people. But it is the people quit. This is a very basic economics explanation. You follow? I'm going to talk about Japan. Japan has been in recession for more than 20 years. And yet they are not going bankrupt. The people are still gainfully employed. And despite the high cost of living, they can still survive. The Japanese are workaholics and they save a lot of money. The government has to actually beg the people, the Japanese people, to use their money. Kalau tidak, ekonomi tempatan, or we call the endogenous economics, is not going to survive. Because the industry in Japan itself is going to die because the local people keep all their money in the banks. Diorang bukan tiada duit tau. Diorang kemulut ekonomi ya, is because diorang Japanese people refuse to spend. They have money but they tidak mau pakai duit. That is their recession. Kita punya recession, kita mau beli ba, tapi kita kosong ba, tiada duit. It's different, you know. And do you know that in Malaysia, when I came back in the 80s, a little bit earlier than Peter, kita punya undang-undang says that duit dalam akaun yang dormant, 5 years, the money is tutup, send to Bank Negara. Kalau kamu balik, you have to go and make an application to claim your money from Bank Negara. Now I heard it's only what, 2 years or 1 year. Itu duit semua pergi Bank Negara. So, in the country called Taiwan, when I was there about 10 years ago, the government very moderately. Bonds are actually like loans, and one of the most successful bonds that have ever happened in Malaysia was, I think, more than 15, 18 years ago, Bond Cakamas. You buy at 75 ringgit, selepas 5 tahun they pay you back 100 ringgit. Very successful. And apparently, government and big companies are in the habit of raising money through bonds because it is cheaper than borrowing from the banks. But when the bonds are matured, when you have to pay back the money that you took, it has to be done in the currency that you obtained it in the first place. So when you run out of US dollar to pay your US dollar bonds, you have to go to the open market to buy, isn't it? And these money suppliers, the currency suppliers, they will ask a bond from you, which means to say, you want my US dollar, you pay more with your ringgit, because your economy is risky. The fundamentals are almost non-existent. You pay more. That is one way the ringgit value fell. And the number two way is this. You know, FDIs. When the foreign investors lose confidence or bring their ringgit currency exchange and then bring who supplies all the US dollars? Bank Negara, isn't it? Now let me ask you, if you are a foreign investor and you want to move your money out of Malaysia, you go and exchange it in the banks, and of course they go through Bank Negara. If Bank Negara say, oh, all your ringgit, you want US dollar, you pay 5 ringgit lah, give you 1 US. Boleh kah? Boleh lah kan? Which means to say, somehow or other, the drop of the ringgit is condoned by Bank Negara. I mean, that is my way of looking at it. If I'm Bank Negara, I have a lot of US dollar. This foreign investor wants to leave the country, and I know it's not coming back. If your ringgit banyak kan? So, you want my US dollar, boleh ba? Instead of 3 ringgit, instead of him paying 3 ringgit for 1 US dollar, you pay 5 ringgit lah. Or 4.5. You pay more ringgit, I give you 1 US dollar. So that is one way to understand why it is happening. two methods. I may be wrong. Maybe there are three. Municipal bonds are actually, it happens only in overseas countries when a new mayor is elected. He will raise money through municipal bonds to run the city. And usually before he steps down, the bonds are matured. Okay. Can I ask for the first picture? This is Lee Ka-shing. He is the richest man in Asia for almost 30 years. More than 25 years ago, I attended a gala dinner by tycoons and philanthropists in Hong Kong. He was asked, why is he so successful? And how he did it. He gave a one sentence reply. He said, find a basic need and fill it. And he thought a while and he had to say. Now, setiap orang, setiap pagi bila kamu bangun, most of you will go and brush your teeth, isn't it? If now, after 52 years, orang Sabah pakai penyakit itu burus gigi ya, is still imported, am I right? Why? Bukan saja burus gigi, ubat gigi, sabun mandi, I mean all the detergent to wash our dishes, our clothing, everything. It's not made in Sabah. Something is wrong with us, isn't it? We cannot always blame the government, you know. Economy is very consumer driven. For what I remember, Stevens, it was timber. In fact, even lawyers at that time were doing more timber agreements more than fighting cases in court. It was timber. And then came oil and gas. Now this oil and gas thing is actually a curse, you know. It can be a curse to Sabah, it can also be a curse to Petronas. But what I understand is the signing away of our oil rights was not done with the permission of the people of Sabah. There was no referendum. There was no resolution or motion discussed or passed in the State Legislative Assembly. But the agreement that was signed is legal, you know. Apa yang bukan is, it is not legitimate. It is legal, but it's not legitimate. Okay. Like the giving away of Labuan, it's legal. The instruments of handing over the proclamation, everything done legally. But was it legitimate? Now, there are constitutional documents to support the legality of the handing over. But the thing is, it can also be reversed. Ma. Am I right? Because the assembly is supreme, parliament is supreme. Apa yang sudah buat salah boleh diperbetulkan dengan akta ataupun enactment yang seterusnya. So it is up to the two governments to deal with this. But of course, it is also depending on the people of Sabah whether they want it done. And then we have now the export of CPO. How much has the export of CPO benefited each and every Sabahan? Tiada kan? Only the stakeholders and the players in the oil palm industry. So you cannot say that we are export driven. We are very much consumer driven, because everything that is being marketed and sold here is supaya pengguna di Sabah boleh menggunakannya. Okay, so you will find that we have no manufacturing industries. We cannot be self-reliant because we have to depend on ini kapal-kapal yang membawa barangan ini daripada luar Sabah untuk mengisi keperluan rakyat jelata Sabah. So, you ponder on it and see siapa yang salah, kerajaan ataupun rakyat sendiri ataupun pengusaha yang mempunyai kemampuan untuk menukarkan keadaan ini. Item 6. Can I have the second picture? This is Monaco. I've been there maybe a couple of times. And it's actually a small place. Secara resmi, keluasan Monaco 2 kilometer persegi. 2. It's like 2 kilometer kali 1 kilometer. So 2 kilometer persegi. It's almost like the size of Kota Kinabalu town. 36,000 people in the population. 36,000. Kita di Sabah 3.2 juta. They have 36,000 people there staying there. And the GDP, gross domestic product, or what, KDNK, lebih 645,000 ringgit. 645,000 ringgit. Now, GDP is not a yardstick to measure personal wealth. It is a barometer for standard of living. Now, Malaysia, seluruh Malaysia, lebih 300,000 kilometer persegi. 30 juta orang. GDP less than 47,000 ringgit. Monaco, 645,000 ringgit. Whole of Malaysia, 47,000 ringgit. We have more than 70,000 square kilometers, 3.2 million people, and our GDP is less than 1,000 ringgit. And we have so much natural resources, and yet we cannot even sustain ourselves. What is happening? The only natural resource Monaco has is ikan saja. And the rest, tourism, casino, hospitality, F1 racing. This is a negara yang berdaulat tau. Diorang punya security issues, diorang punya tentera zero. Mereka dilindungi oleh negara Perancis. The French army is looking after the sovereignty and security of this sovereign state. They do not have to spend money to feed armies, navies, and air force when the money can be used. On the people. What is the ratio of the utang of Malaysia to the GDP? How many of you know? The government is saying it's less than 55%. The blocs are saying about 70%. Some foreign media is reporting 83%. Now, it's like this. In economics, it's like, I'll give you a simpler form. Kalau kamu punya nisbah utang kepada KDNK is 83%, bermakna setiap 100 ringgit yang ada, 83 ringgit bayar utang. So is that high? High, isn't it? I mean, even if you believe the government statistics at less than 55%, it's still a lot, isn't it? Which means to say that whatever you make, half pergi bayar utang. Now, let me ask you, does a high ratio of debt to the GDP signifies bankruptcy? The answer is no. Now, I'll give you an example. Greece, dia punya nisbah utang kepada KDNK is more than 150%. And earlier on, has been in recession for more than 20 years. Dia punya nisbah utang kepada KDNK is more than 230%. But they are not bankrupt. They're still richer than almost half the world. So, I'll give you another example, our nearest neighbor, Singapore. The ratio of the debt to the GDP is more than 110%. And still, the people there are living better than us. Why? Utang kita baru about, say, less than 55%. Mau mati sudah. But Singapore, more than 110%. They can still afford F1, they can still afford what casino, what there, everything. Why? So there is a difference between liquidity and solvency. And it doesn't mean that when you have no utang, your life will be better. Now, in fact, not just me. Every economist should be able to explain how having no utang doesn't actually change the quality of life. I give you this story, which is very, very common. There is this village town. in the UK. They have a recession, semua orang hutang, and everyone is living on credit. And one day, a tourist came to the town, and he entered a budget hotel there. Before they check in, they will always want to look at the condition of the hotel. So they masuk itu hotel, the reception sana, dia simpan £100 on the counter. It's equivalent to almost 700 ringgit now in Malaysia. So they kasih tahu itu hoteler, who is also the cook, the janitor, the bellboy, everything lah, you know. I will go up to your hotel room to see whether I like it or not. If I like it, I will stay. If I don't want it to £100 on. And while he was up there, the hotelier took the £100, ran out. Dia pergi jumpa dia punya butcher, bah. Tu yang supply daging sama dia tu. Dia ada hutang, bah. So dia pergi bayar dia punya hutang. Dia bilang, my hutang selesai, ya? Okay. And the butcher, the tukang jual daging punya, dia ambil itu 100. Dia bayar itu yang the poultry farmer. Itu poultry farmer took the £100, dia lari pergi itu pasal ini kampung bahan, village kan. Dia lari pergi itu yang jual itu bajak, bajak ayam, bajak ite, bajak kambing semua itu kan, the feed seller. Nah, ini duit kau ambil lah, saya punya hutang habis lah. Okay, and you know what? The feed seller, sama juga, ada hutang juga. So dia bawa itu duit £100, dia pergi lari. Kau tahu siapa dia pergi cari? The local village prostitute. Sebab dalam perawatan itu pelacur bagi perkhidmatan on credit, bah. So dia tahu itu ano selesai asalnya. And you know what? It comes back. I say the cycle lah. The pelacur lari pergi balik itu hotel sana. Dalam recession itu pelanggan yang saya bawa itu bilik semua sewa utang punya kan. Sekarang saya bayar sama kamu, ha? Nomor utang, ha? Okay. The hoteler itu duit £100 simpan balik atas itu counter. The tourist come down. Kau punya bilik ini semua, ayah, tak boleh harap dia. Saya tidak mau lah. So he took his £100 and left. Now you see, nobody earn anything, you know. But in a matter of maybe half an hour, utang semua hapus, bah. Now you see, you may not have utang, but that doesn't mean you will have a better quality of life because you have no growth. And why? Kenapa itu duit ya circulation lah? In a cycle, kan? And still come back to not is because of utang. Ini utang sama ada kita sendiri rakyat yang mencipta ini utang untuk membebankan kita ataupun kerajaan yang membebankan kita. So you see this utang thing will take away your quality of life. So a lot of people, a lot of my own pupils, they do not understand. So they ask me,
Dua minit.
Okay, thank you. Dia tanya saya, who is the tourist? I told them, the foreign investors are the tourists. And who are the hoteliers? The middle class rakyat. Middle class means it can be you and me, okay? And then who is the butcher? The butcher are the retailers. The retailers are like Kedai Runcit, Giant, Survey, okay? And who are the poultry farmers? They are the manufacturers, the factories that produce the product. And who are the feed supplier? The working class. Semua yang bekerja, kola putih kah, kola hijau kah, kola biru kah, the working class. And I stopped there. After a few days, he came back, the students came back. Who is the prostitute? The prostitutes are the politicians lah. Yang hari-hari ya, everyone screw sama dia punya. Our politicians being screwed daily. It can be in the media, it can be on Facebook, it can be. Yes. So you see, yeah, it's a vicious cycle. So I'm only at item number 6, but I'm out of time. I have 20 issues, but I think I have to stop here. Anyone who wants to come back for more will have to contact the organizer, Pipa. We'll have to do it in another forum on another day. Thank you very much for coming.